गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। हाँ
आवाज है ना सर?
सर, हेलो सर।
हाँ हाँ सर, हाड़ी तोड़ सर।
बोला सर, बोला।
हाँ, काय कोणाचे प्रश्न नाही, पुढचं सेशन
ओके
चालू
हेलो।
करतोय। हाँ, ओके
ओके
ओके, थँक यू सर, थँक यू थँक
ओके। गुड
यू।
आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। आई एम गोइंग टू इंट्रोड्यूस the paper presentation chairman professor dr lokhande sir completed phd and phd degree from UAR university kolhapur presently working as a professor at the department of karmavir babu patil college pandharpur district kolhapur sir have 4 years teaching experience and presently सर यू चेयरमैन ऑफ जॉयसी पुण्य श्लोक एग्रीमेंट बोलकर सोलापुर यूनिवर्सिटी सोलापुर सर पब्लिश्ड 110 नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल पेपर सर हैव कंप्लीटेड सर आल्सो गाइडेड टू 11 स्टूडेंट फॉर पीएचडी एंड नाउ करंटली 11 स्टूडेंट हैव अवार्डेड द पीएचडी under the guidance of Dr. Lokhande sir. He was awarded best teacher by government of Maharashtra. So in brief, I introduce to Dr. Lokhande sir. After that, I am going to introduce Dr. Tipe sir, reporter Tipe sir, head and associate professor in Vasundhara Kala Mahavidyalaya Solapur. Sir is also a research guide. Sir completed SET exam in 2002 and PhD in 2010 by Ramanand Tirtha University Nanded. Sir also BOS member of Solapur University and secretary of Bhugol Shikshak Sangh Solapur. Thank you. Introduce Chairman Dr. Lokhande sir and Dr. Tipe sir. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Dr. Dede sir. Now I hand over the chair to Dr. Tipe sir. Dr. Tipe sir, is it audible?
Yes, I am audible.
Tipe sir, Dr. Tipe sir.
गुड आफ्टरनून हाउ द डिग्नेचरीज आई पार्टिसिपेंट इन दिस वन डे इंटर डिसिप्लिनरी इंटरनेशनल ऑनलाइन कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑन एनवायरमेंटल चेंज गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल द डिग्निटरीज एंड पार्टिसिपेंट इन दिस वन डे इंटरडिसिप्लिनरी इंटरनेशनल ऑनलाइन कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑन एनवायरमेंटल चेंजेस बायोडाइवर्सिटी एंड सस्टेनेबल रिसोर्स मैनेजमेंट The chief organizer of this conference, Dr. D. M. Bhanje, Principal Santosh Bhimrao, convener Dr. of Geography, all the research persons and participants. In this technical session, some participants are going to present their papers, as the number of papers is more. So, let us first present the papers. To present the research papers, first of all, I would like to call first number paper, name of the paper presented. डेढ़ सर लिस्ट है क्या? हाँ लिस्ट एक नंबर कौन है?
माने सर, माने लिस्ट है, माने सर अनुराव।
हेलो माने सर, हेलो माने सर
बोला। हाँ पहले कौन है ते हे करा।
ओके ओके वेलकम टू सयाद तादी वेस्ट बंगाल कल्याण यूनिवर्सिटी सयाद तादी। पाटिल सर यू आर ऑडिबल?
पाटिल सर
हेलो। अरुण पाटिल ना?
हेलो हेलो पाटिल सर यू आर ऑडिबल?
यस यस आई ऑडिबल।
ओके ओके स्टार्ट सर।
हेलो हेलो सर। ओके माझा आवाज येतो सर?
हा येतो, चालू करा।
ओके वेलकम वेलकम। हेलो वन इन ऑल, आय एम मिस्टर पाटील संदीप अर्जुन, रिसर्च स्कॉलर स्टूडेंट डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी डॉक्टर बी आर आंबेडकर मराठवाडा युनिव्हर्सिटी औरंगाबाद। On these occasions, auspicious occasion, I am going to present to research paper on vegetation analysis in Radhanagri Tehsil using geoinformatics. Next is scheme of presentation. This is the scheme of presentation. I will begin with the relevance of topic. Then I will go through objective, database, study area, and methods. Finally, I will conclude the same. Next, so friends, as well, now that vegetation is the basis of the life on this mother earth, in view of that an attempt has been made to evaluate the existing vegetation condition in Radhanagri Tehsil of Kolhapur, Maharashtra, India using Landsat multispectral data, various indicators. Example, NRVI, NDVI, SAVI, RVI have been computed a geospatial environment. Next one, objectives of the study. The special objective of present study is, first is to study the physiographic aspect of study area. Second is to assess the spatial distribution of vegetation in study area by using remote sensing data and geospatial tools. Next is a study area. The Radhanagri Tehsil of Kolhapur district has been selected as the study area for present research work. This is the study area of my research paper. This is the database that we have used, which Landsat 8 OLI data, shuttle radar topographic mission, dam and rainfall data obtained from global weather data. Research methodology. Here is the methodology that we have used for the vegetation analysis. The stream data has been processed in Saga software and slope enhancer and Absolutes relief is accessed the Landsat data of 18 March 2019 has been imported in IRDAS imaging software, where top of atmospheric green, red and IR band have been obtained. The some bands have been extracted according to study area and imported into the QGIS environment, where vegetation analysis has carried out by procuring NRVI, NDVI, SAVI and RVI. Next is the result and discussion. Radhanagri Tehsil digital elevation model This map is Radhanagari Tehsil slope in degrees. This map is Radhanagari Tehsil hillshed pattern. Second is Radhanagari Tehsil drainage network. Radhanagari Tehsil accurate heights, topographic wetness index. Radhanagari Tehsil average annual rainfall in 1979 to 2013. Next one, Radhanagari Tehsil minimum and maximum temperature in 1979 to 2030. Next is this map showing normalized ratio vegetation in Radhanagari Tehsil. In this map, brown color present in low normalized ratio vegetation ratio and green color present in high vegetation normalized ratio. Second map is Radhanagari Tehsil normal difference vegetation index. This map is the atmospherically resident vegetation index. Then Radhanagari Tehsil soil adjusted vegetation index. Last one is a conclusion. During the last 3 decades, vegetation index have been extensively used for studying and monitoring vegetation conditions such as health, growth level, production, water and nutrients, streets, etc. In view of that, vegetation analysis of the study area has been carried out by using remote sensing data, where different vegetation index with NDVI, SVVI, NRVI and RV have been carried out. The study emphasized that evergreen to semi-evergreen and decades forest spreads over the western and southwestern region of the study area, which has shown higher chlorophyll content having dense to moderately dense canopy of this of the vegetation, whereas lower value of the obtained indicates have been demonstrated that the vegetation in vegetation is under streets which have been specifically spreads over traversing middle hills and the northeastern part of the tehsil that at most needed to procure under floral growth in the region. Afroforestation through agroforestry, social forestry are some of the alternatives that could be helpful to bring enriched biodiversity in this region. My research work. Thanks for your kindly attention.
Thank you, Sandeep Patil, for your nice presentation on the vegetation index. After this, I would like to call D.B. Nagamurugan, Anna University, Tamil Nadu, for the next presentation.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sir, is my screen visible, sir?
Yeah.
Hello, sir. My screen visible?
Oh, it is.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, yes. Your screen is visible. You can continue.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Nagamurugan from Sri Ram Union College, Department of Mechanical Engineering, final year student. And I'm here to talk about my presentation, Rivers of India, not at all. It's time to clean the rivers of India. Yes, and this is about my presentation. It's about regarding a paper of homemade sewage treatment plant. What is the need and necessity of a homemade sewage treatment plant, where a sewage treatment plant is a term which is definitely related to industrial concept. Let's get in. Before that, we have to understand the problem statement. So these are the major rivers of India, which is a power source for producing the water in India, which is River Ganga, River Brahmaputra, River Indus, and many more rivers like Tapti, Mahanadi. But taking in the capacity value, River Ganga stands first. Okay, so this is water potential of India. But taking and typing Google how is a high polluted rivers in India, still River Ganga stands first. So see, we are considering River Ganga as one of our holy river, but still it stands in the first place in polluted. So how can we accept that the country's first water source place is polluted in same. So this is one of the major issue what we are facing environmentally, and water we discussed, but still this is one of the thing where you should take our concern. If the present is saying that we are having high polluted, then there will be no place or no pure water for our future generations. So we have to consider this and take it concern. When we take up to the problem, why river Ganga gets polluted, and this entire research survey has been taken for about the past 10 years, and what are the reasons on it is considered. After the government has started to take strict policies, and on even the ministry has been, all several ministers have been formed as single ministry previous year under some ministry of gel or something, I forgot. But as necessary reforms has been taken place from central government in India, but still river, the pollution of the river stand high. As because after the taking several concerns, factually industries were standard first during pollution of river Ganga and their contribution. But after several strict stringent actions followed by implementing compulsory sewer treatment plants, compulsory water treatment after before releasing water outside when entering the Ganga, and after that several things concerned, still the pollution was high. After finding the several reasons, this is a major pollutant. The first place chances household sewage waste and not the industrial wastewater is the reason. Currently, the river Ganga is getting polluted. The sewage waste water, which is generated from a house, like from water from toilets, water from our waste, all these things are actually polluting the river. And the second thing is dustbin usage. Whenever we go, when foreign people cross any river, they will see and enjoy the nature. But what our people do, they will go and take all the clothes, they will wash, they will bath, again they will throw their plastic waste inside the river. Then that's what we show respect towards the river. Now when we see water itself, so we have to due respect for our source as a source giver. But what we are doing is we just go on polluting the same thing whenever we see the river. And now third place comes to industrial wastewater. But even the rules are making stringent, still some of the factors or some of the industries are still making pollution, like textile wastewater. They are the small amount of waste is also still considered to be toxic because drastically kills the microbes. When the microbes get killed, automatically the water will lose its capacity to clean itself. And so these are the main reasons that still River Ganga can't unable to clean itself. The magical miracle in River Ganga is it has ability to clean itself, whatever the waste it has. But the ability or the capacity of property is suddenly drastically decreasing because of the following factors. So these are some of the things that have taken place to stop polluting, stop throwing waste, giving public awareness, and stop allowing the chemicals to mix chemicals. And the effluent treatment plant has been mandated for each and every small industry to large scale industry, which is throwing the water and Ganga near the Ganga sources, and supporting NGOs. Okay, all these things are taken place, and all these necessary actions are taken place. But why still we can't achieve a result? So we have to give something more, right? So if we follow the practice, the same thing what existing is doing, we can only get the same output. So how about as a citizen, can we solve this? As I already said about the first two factors, major pollution is from the side of us, which is about polluting the wastewater from the sewage water, right? So how about treating our own sewage water before mixing in Ganga? It will be sound like hilarious, but it's right. We can treat our own sewage water before letting inside Ganga, because we can't even drink the water that drink the sewage water. But we can treat the sewage water into less harmful than more harmful. So we can treat them. But how it is possible? And there the idea comes called homemade sewage treatment plant. Generally, the sewage treatment plant is a type of plant which is denoted in industries to clean the sewage waters microbe free and increase the microbe content of the water. So in industries, even in India, the industries, what they do is they will use some microbe booster, microbe production booster, which is that cow dung is a natural microbe booster. They will throw cow dung and jaggery to the industrial waste water in bigger tanks. And then the tanks, after two to three days maintenance by giving continuous oxygen support, microbes will automatically generate, and these microbes will automatically kill and give the purified water, which is not fit for drinking, but at least it will be harmless. So this will add the microbe content in the water and increase the ability to perform clean on itself. How about using this same technology, same mechanism to house? Because it's very easy, right? So increasing water content. So we as a citizen, we can definitely solve that. Whenever a river wastewater just try to enter inside the river Ganga, we can easily clean that, because after by taking up the sewage tanks and throwing the local microbe booster, like cow dung is one of the best example for us to increase the microbe content boost. We cannot cow dung as well as jaggery to the sewage water particles, and we can keep the sewage tank open. You may ask that a full smell will come only from the opening. 2 to 3 days we can expect a full smell from the tank, and later from 2 to 3 days automatically the smell will disappear because microbes will start generating, and these microbes will start eating that full smell creators. So that what we can expect is the water will start to clean itself. Means the cow dung and the jaggery will start to produce some microbes, because the water we generate will not be having any harmful chemicals, just like human waste and feces. So for that we can use the same natural mechanism like cow dung, but many people are trying to follow that and they are not ready to do, or they are not getting a proper explanation to approach them. But my idea was to implement them practically, and this experimental result actually these are the water parameters what I have to judge for BOD, COD, TSS, pH value, color and odor. But because of lockdown, I was unable to implement my idea due to laboratory testing. But actually, I started the water for laboratory testing to treat the water in a jar. Where from Tamil Nadu, I taken some water from sewage water and start to add some cow dung and jaggery. So the work is going on. And this is what are the advantages of this specific homemade sewage treatment plant. So no support needed from government. We are not going to ask the government about some of any other things. For example, if we take NGOs, they will be needing some amount to take care of all these costly activities to clean the river water. So they will be needing some fund from industries as well as NGO. So this is a cost economic method. So now we are not going to go shop on buying any fertilizers or any special chemical treating healing agents or treating agents to clean. They're just going to take a cow dung, which is ordinarily automatically available from the morning of the day. Take them and pour them jaggery. And at the night time when you open, it's more than enough to produce microbe content. Then increasing my bacterial content. What is this is another specialty of our project. When we increase bacterial content in our water, automatically the microbe content will have a boost in its count. And if we flow the boosted count water directly river Ganga, the existing microbial count will get connected to our present boosted microbial count, and this will summarily increase the microbial capacity of the water. And what the result when the microbial content of the water increases, automatically it will restrain its property of cleaning itself. So it is one of the main goal we can achieve here. And we can easily indirectly control water pollution, because as I said above, the industries has become following stringent tools. They are decreasing its chemicals, but still we are now wasting. We have been blaming all of the industries, and they are the people who are responsible for polluting. But today we are polluting. But if we follow this step, we can decrease our level of pollution creation, and we can also increase the level of microbe content. And no highly toxic gases or anything occurs when we're following this. Some people ask that if you open the lid of the sewage tanker to enter the oxygen, they'll ask what will happen if some harmful gases like methane exposed. Right, methane will expose, but methane is not so much powerful. Our generated methane is not so much powerful as compared to some of the gases which is liberated in industries or something. And you are not going to open the sewage at the daytime. We are only going to open the sewage at the night time. And this is okay, this is nothing. Because even at some places, the sewages are open space. What the reason? Because the open spaces, they need air to enter. So that if the air enters, there will be having the atmosphere to boost the microbe content. So there will be no toxic gases except methane. Even methane gives a full smell. After 2 to 3 days continuous opening of the lid, even the smell will disappear. So this is a project with having a zero cost with full and advantages. The main purpose of this, the main concept of this project is to increase microbe content in our home human generated sewage water. So as already said, if the water generates inside, it will increase. Any queries from the presentation? Hello? And today we are letting the government to sell water so much in terms of both Rail Neer or whatever it is, but we should not let government to sell air tomorrow, because already in Delhi, before few months in Delhi, air has started to sell for a specific amount of due to high pollution content in Delhi. We should not let to continue this. So we should make India green India and make proud of us. And thanks for watching.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Thank you.
Am I audible? Mr. Naga?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I have one doubt. You have presented very nicely this homemade sewage treatment plant. And for that, you have shown the case studies related to the river and river pollution. Okay, have you checked the preliminary characteristics of the river water sample?
No, sir, I haven't tested, but there is some survey implemented in 2017 and 2014. Some person filed an RTA Act against the government to to find the necessary parameters and the content found in River Ganga, and he said that there was a very less improvement found. So I can take that sample as my reference.
Okay, exactly what is your work? I can't understand, sir, because you have not presented your result also.
No, sir, yes, actually this is my work. The first option is to create public awareness in terms of technically, so what we can do or what we are not doing currently, and the result what we can do and the advantages. And the second thing is I want to increase microbial content in our necessary resource water, because nobody is going to come and do, and nobody can't, instead of cleaning a river, nobody can't pour a lorry of cow dung or jaggery inside. So we people, if we start to create some changes here, it will definitely reflect in the river base increasing microbial content. It's my research, but still lockdown, I cannot go to laboratories and test the BOD, COD as compared to the RTA report, what I explained above.
Have you heard about this biological or biochemically change in the water quality? If you are added this organic matter containing this jaggery and as well as this cow dung, so will you aware about that? Is there any change biochemically?
The decision why I taken cow dung is just on cow dung is an example. We can take the local microbe feeder. So the reason why I taken is when I go to ask about some industries, how about the treatment of their sewage treatment plant, they say.
This particular work has been carried out, or which key reference you have referred for this work?
Sir, actually,
how this idea came in your mind?
Sir, actually, I have gone to an internship at May about HPL, Hindustan Biotechnology Limited, which is a pharma company, which is currently running by Government of India. And there I went to the home sewage treatment plant section about that. I investigated personally and I found that at the same place for the ETP and STP plant, ETP some chemicals and added some water.
Yes, I understood. Just I want to one more question ask to you. Have you developed or designed this particular homemade sewage treatment plant? As an engineer, what is your contribution in this overall work?
Sir, actually, I'm from mechanical engineer, sir. So
yes, here I understood. Yes, I understood. But as an engineer, he has to design some ETP or related to the work. So have you done that work, or you have only done this data collection or this presentation?
Yes, sir. I have done only the data collection as well as water sample collection and practicing experiment. The slide what I show you before the last report slide is an empty tabular column. It was empty.
Because this is a very vast area, and in this particular area, you should know about the biotechnology, biology, or environmental parameter, even the factors when they the characteristics changes on the basis of the factors also. There are some factors which are mostly affecting on the characteristics of the water also. So you have to know about this So I think you should keep this all the points in your mind, and you have to focus on this particular work. This is very nice, but you have to
focus on include your work. Okay, sir.
Yeah?
Okay, sir. Definitely, sir. Thanks for this, sir.
Okay. Thank you, DB Nagamurugana, for the nice presentation, and which is definitely helpful to the other researchers. After this, I would like to invite Lakshmikant Shivdas Harne, Sant Gadge Baba University, Amravati, on the topic socio-economic and psychological impact of COVID-19 on migrants worker after returning to their native place, interrelation with the migrants workers after returning to their native place, a study with Wasim district. Okay, Dr. Lakshmikant Harne, sir.
Hello, awaaz yetoy sir maza?
Yes, yetoy awaaz sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. Sir, particularly my study is about the migration of the labor, and as the title of our conference contains, the sustainable development. So sustainable development of a country, of any area, or of total world, the concept of sustainable development cannot be completed, or we cannot think about the sustainable development without considering the migrant workers or human beings. So I have particularly studied what problems the migrant workers are facing after returning to their native place, because during this lockdown period, since March, most of the migrant laborers, or we can say all of the migrant laborers, have faced so many problems, like jobless, they have no jobs, they have no money, they have no food. So due to such all problems, they left from their workplaces, and due to government has stopped all the transportation means. So due to this another problem, many of the migrant workers started to walk to their native places. So this was the major psychological and physical wrong impact was on their minds as well as on their bodies. Anyhow, they reached at their destinies, means at their native places, because
here I can hear.
Wherever they were working, in Mumbai, in Pune, in Nagpur, or New Delhi, or Bangalore, wherever. So most of the migrant workers started to walk to their home. So after walking for 500 kilometers, 200 kilometers, 1000 kilometers, anyhow they reached their native place, or we can say their villages. So after reaching, many of the migrants, means simply suppose we have, we can say that 10 migrant workers are coming in my village. So I have stopped them. I have asked them to leave outside of the village. You can't mix up with people. So such type of harassment, mental harassment, was faced by migrant workers on arrival at their villages and by their near and dears. So due to such various reasons, due to such various problems, psychological conditions of some migrant workers were disturbed. Already they were facing the economic problems, and they also faced the social problems. Social problems means here, they become simply migrant workers become untouchables at their village after arrival. So I have studied these all things in my research work. I have studied all these things for more than one and a half month. I went to various villages which are nearer to Mangrulpir taluka. Mangrulpir is a taluka in Vashim district of Vidarbha region. Okay, so you can see these are some of the my hypotheses and with objectives. So I have studied what type of problems they are facing, and more than psychological, more than social problems, economic problems, they were facing some another problems also. So that things I have studied. So first, I have framed a null hypothesis. Three null hypotheses were there. That first was there is no significant difference between economic conditions of migrant workers at workplace and after returning to their native place. So for testing of this hypothesis, to for gathering information about this, I have placed interview schedule before the migrant workers at their villages. So near about we can't say all, but more than 80%, more than 90% migrant workers said that their economic conditions are not so well, or they are facing some economic problems at their native place. But at the same time, when I asked them how your economic condition was at your workplace, then 106 of them said that it was good at that place. But after coming back to their native place, only 12 migrant workers said that we have enough money to run our bread and butter. So here results also presented in this table. 33 migrant workers said that we had adequate money to run our bread and butter at the workplace. But when they come to native place, only 15 migrant workers, means the number is reduced by more than 50%. So they were telling that we have no enough money. And 125 migrant workers were facing the economic problems, and they said that economic conditions were badly affected when they arrived at their native place. And lastly, very few workers, that is number 12, very less workers have good economic conditions after arriving at their native place. So this was the difference between their economic conditions. So I found that the economic conditions of migrant workers were declining and badly affected due to returning back to their native places. So what happened after returning to returning back to their villages? No one was ready to give them work in farms also, or they were unable to do any type of other work because of the lockdown. And the villagers and their near and dears asked them to remain quarantined for more than 14 days. Some of the migrant workers said that they were are living in the schools which are out of the village for more than 1 month or 1.5 month. So due to this, they were unable to work and their economic conditions were declined. So this was the first hit to all migrant workers, that they have lost their financial power, they have lost their money in their hands, which was at the place of work. So then second table is third table was is there, which is depicting what I have found during my research. Now we know that, sir, everyone is seeing another person with a doubt that whether he have a whether he is affected with corona. Everyone have doubts in their mind about others. So I have tried to know the behavior of the family members and the villagers of the migrant workers. So here the villagers were not behaved good or not shown good manners with the migrant workers when they returned to their villages. So here we can see that the more than 100 migrant workers expelled from village, means they were not allowed to enter to the village. Then again I asked them another one question, if no one is expelling you, then how was behavior of villagers? So remaining persons told that everyone was hesitated to talk with us or to speak with us or to sit with us, and no one was speaking to us. Only 7 migrant workers told that.
Sir, yes, sir, please conclude your paper.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. So this was the bad conditions which are faced by migrant workers at their native place. So within 2 minutes, sir, I will within 1 minute I will conclude. So due to joblessness, financial problems, migrant workers are facing a lot of problems right now after returning at their village. So I would like to suggest the local bodies or the government that the scope of MNREGA should be widened and more workers should be given the work and the wages. And then another thing, somewhere or at some places, police administration have lodged cases against the migrant workers for abolishing the Act of Disaster Management. So as per Supreme Court's order, all the cases which were lodged against migrant workers must be withdrawn by the central and state government. So thank you for giving me an opportunity. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for this nice presentation.
Okay.
After that, I would like Pallavi Kulkarni, Savitribai Phule University, Pune University, Pune, on the topic analyzing the rainfall and groundwater level data for identification of breaks and their interrelationship in Upper Godavari Basin. Pallavi Kulkarni.
Yes, sir, I'm ready. Just give me a moment to add presentation.
Okay, madam. You should present your paper within 5 minutes, madam. Maximum 5 minutes you have.
Okay. Hello?
Yes, madam.
Are my slides visible?
Yeah, visible, madam. Continue. So just present. No.
There are multiple maps actually.
No, you can select your presentation, madam. You can display your presentation. Yeah, click on presentation. Yes.
My slides are actually not visible here.
Okay. No, please open your PPT, no?
PPT is open.
No, yet it is not displayed here, no? Yeah, yes, now it is displayed. Yeah, you can continue, madam.
You can see my PPT?
No, just before 1 minute I see, but now not. Just you click on the PPT. Yeah. Yes.
Now it is open?
Yeah, it is easy. It is open and you can continue it.
Okay, thank you. And sorry for the inconvenience.
Okay, continue, madam.
I'll keep it, it is as it is now.
Yeah, no problem, madam.
Okay. Sorry for the inconvenience. My name is Pallavi Kulkarni and I am from Department of Geography, Savitribai Phule University. My current research is based on analyzing the rainfall and groundwater levels data for identification of breaks and their interrelationship in the Upper Godavari Basin. This research is guided by Dr. S.D. Pardeshi, who also belongs to the same department. The objectives of the study are to analyze the rainfall and groundwater levels data for identification of breaks and also to check graphically if there are any breaks, whether they coincide with each other. So what exactly are breaks? So breaks are basically the shift or jump in the time series data where after the break year, the means before and after the breaks are different. Here we can see in the figure that before the break, the mean is higher, after it is lower. This is my study area, that is Upper Godavari Basin, located in the state of Maharashtra. For this study, we selected 22 rainfall gauging stations, which are located within and in the close vicinity of the basin. And we have basically analyzed the annual rainfall time series. And for groundwater levels, we have selected two seasons, that is pre-monsoon and post-monsoon. For pre-monsoon seasons, we have selected 151 wells. And for post-monsoon season, we have selected 171 wells. The groups basically are, for group A wells, the data collection began between the period 1980 and 1985. And for group B wells, the data collection began between 1986 and 1990. But the last date of data collection is 2015 only for both the groups. The methodology includes three non-parametric tests. Those are Pettit test, standard normal homogeneity test, and Guichand's test. And level of significance was set to 0.01. The null hypothesis is that there is no break in the data, whereas the alternative hypothesis is that there exists a break in the data, which is statistically significant. So these are the results. When we analyzed the rainfall data, we came to know that there is only one station, Akole, which has the significant break in the data series. Otherwise, all the remaining 21 rainfall stations has a non-significant break. And if we see the distribution of the years of break, we can see that maximum number of rain gauges have experienced the break between the years 1986 and 1990. And afterwards, the stations experiencing the breaks have decreased. Increase of groundwater levels, we can see that there is a bell-shaped curve that shows that maximum of the wells have experienced break during the period of 1991 to 2010 in the pre-monsoon season. And if we check it for the post-monsoon season, a similar shape can be observed, stating the same results that the breaks have occurred maximum between the period 1991 to 2010 or 2005. Now, if we compare graphically the breaks occurred in the pre-monsoon season and the rainfall, we can see that the break in the rainfall series have occurred before, that is between 1986 to 1990, whereas the breaks in the pre-monsoon season have groundwater levels have occurred between 91 to 2010, that is after the breaks in the rainfall time series. Similar trend again is observed in the post-monsoon season, that is the breaks in the groundwater levels have occurred after the rainfall time series. But if we check what happens to the mains before and after the break years, here the first graph shows the rainfall, distribution of mains before and after the break years. Here we can see approximately 55% of the rain gauges show that the mean has increased before the previous, while approximately 45% stations show that mean has decreased. However, in case of pre-monsoon groundwater levels, it shows that more than 60% wells, the mean has decreased. Now, in case of groundwater levels, decreasing mean is a negative connotation, as we can see in the graph here. As we are talking below the surface level, increasing mean denotes that the groundwater levels are falling. Conversely, in case of post-monsoon season, the mean after the break is increasing, like in case of first situation where the groundwater levels are rising. So from this slide, we can conclude that there is something like 50% stations are showing increasing mean after the rainfall. However, that pattern is not observed in case of groundwater levels, and the situation is worst in case of pre-monsoon season, that is just before the onset of monsoon in the months of March and April. The groundwater levels are rapidly decreasing. And that is also the major finding of this study.
Okay, thank you.
The last slide here, it states that the reason for breaking the groundwater levels can be natural or anthropogenic in nature. Here, we are not concluding what is the specific reason. It can be either in response to the rainfall, change in the rainfall, or due to change in the practice, as the rainfall has changed, more water is being abstracted from the groundwater or agriculture, or change in the land use land cover also. So that is the further scope of the study. If there are any questions, or thank you.
Thank you for this presentation. After this, I would like to invite Dr. Prasanna Srinivas from Central University, Karnataka, on the topic isolation of fungal endophytes and growth hormones from the and its impact on the plant growth. Please, Dr. Prasanna Srinivas, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Am I audible, sir? Hello?
You are audible, sir.
Yeah, I'm sharing the screen.
Hello, Tepe sir.
So my screen is visible? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I'll be speaking about the isolation of fungal endophytes and their growth hormones from Santalum album and its effect of plant growth in Bacopa, Moneri and Alternanthera sessiles. The objectives of the work was to isolate the endophytic fungi from the roots of medicinal plant Santalum album, and then investigate the effect of growth promoters by selective endophytic fungi on plant growth. Then quantification of the growth promoters by HPLC. The materials and methods include, my sample was collected in Bangalore near Dhanabharati, Dhanvantri Vana. Telling about Santalum album, it belongs to the order Santalins and family Santanaceae. It's one of the indigenous plant in South India and grows in the Western Ghats. It has been actually very useful in the industry as a extraction of sandalwood oil. With this background, the plant was selected for the study and has got a lot of traditional medicinal importance, like the oil is used as an antiseptic and astringent and for the treatment of headache, stomachache, urinary and genital disorders. The paste of the sandalwood has been used for a lot of inflammatories and diseases and all. With this background, actually the study was taken up and the roots of the plant was collected. So the sample collection was like this. The roots were collected from the healthy plants and kept in sterile containers, and then it was going for sampling. So here the roots were taken, and it was actually surface disinfection was done with alcohol and sodium hypochlorite so that the surface microflora will not grow, and only the endophytes which are there in the roots of the plant, inside the roots of the plant, only that was to be isolated. With this, the root bits were processed, and then it was plated on potato dipsis agar, supplemented with streptomycin. It was sealed with parafilm and incubated at 28 degrees centigrade for 4 to 6 weeks, because it takes at least 3 weeks for the growth to come. The endophytic fungi was identified by using a stain called methylene blue, and then studied for the morphological characteristics. Using the Barnett manual, it was actually identified, the name of the fungus was identified, and also the culture was sent for Agarkar Research Institute, Pune, for confirmation. The study of auxins was done by using a methodology called the Salkowski's method, where 1 ml of the supernatant, means the fungi has to be grown in the broth, PDB, potato dipsis broth, and then 1 ml of the supernatant should be taken and treated with Salkowski's reagent so that it develops a pink coloration in 20 minutes at room temperature. Then the study of the growth promoters was also continued with the pot trial method, where the culture filtrate was supplied to the plant in the soil, and then it was checked for the height of the plant in centimeters and number of leaves, number of branches, and size of the leaf blade. The selected plants for the study was Alternanthera sessilis and Bacopa moneri. Bacopa moneri is used for as an Ayurvedic plant for memory, and Alternanthera sessilis is also very important as an antibacterial and used for infections. With this background, so pot trial was conducted. Then finally, the broth was also going for our HPLC, high pressure liquid chromatography technique, and seen for how much the auxins was produced. The quantification was done. Coming to results and discussion, the endophytic fungi isolated from the plant Santalum album had different species. So as you see the picture here, this is the fungal isolates which were grown on the plate on the artificial medium, and the different fungi was identified, and it was found to be Calyropsis species, Poma glomerata, Colletotrichum species, and Fusarium solani. So these were identified using the manual, and as well it was sent for the Agarkar Institute in Pune for confirmation. And here you are seeing the detection of the indolecic acid by Salkowski's method, where the four fungi, important fungi, Fusarium solani, Poma glomerata, Colletotrichum species, and Calyropsis. Among these, Fusarium solani gave a positive result. So that was the culture which was continued for further pot trial methodology. So here you are seeing the pot trial method, where the Alternanthera sessilis results are like this, where the plant was supplied with the crude broth of the fungi, and it was found that the height of the plant was, there was a control also for the same plant, and in the, and it was found that the growth was good with Fusarium solani after supplying 14 centimeters per height and 1.33 branches, and length of the branches was 4 when you compare the control. Control was 2.5, whereas it was for the, with the supply of the broth, it showed length to be 4.3, which is a tremendous, which is definitely a good result. Followed by the same, the hormones were supplied even for Bacopa moneri, the plant, where it was, again, you see the control, it was 6.56 for the height, whereas when you supplied the same to the Fusarium solani broth for the plant of Bacopa moneri, it was 7.36. So we can see the data, number of leaves was 8, whereas it was, for control, it was 5. So with this data, and I've also done the graph here, you can see the graph. So graphical representation also shows that a standard deviation was there, but it was a good result what was obtained. And the broth was finally going for the HPLC study, high pressure liquid chromatography study. And there you can find that the retention time was 3.03, and the corresponding area was 117, giving a concentration of 4.48 micrograms per ml. And hence auxins are present in the Fusarium solani fungus, and it was also produced in the plant. So what can we understand by this? We can understand that the endophytes present in the plant roots of any plant, but here I've taken up an example of Santalum album, it will produce the growth hormones called auxins. Other than the plant producing, and the fungi also produces, and hence there can be a better growth of the plant. With this idea, can't we use the Fusarium salani culture and produce the auxins, and then why can't we use it as a metabolite externally as a fertilizer, in the sense as a bioinoculant in the for the plants to enhance the growth. Okay, so this is what my work was basically. So mainly it was on isolating an endophytic fungi, producing the auxins in the broth, and then supplying them to the, first find out whether auxins are present, then supply them to the plants and see whether there was a better growth. Thank you. I'm really thanking you, because it was a good platform for me to share my project and research works. I thank all the organizing committees for giving me an opportunity. Thank you once again.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Prasanna Srinivas, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I would conclude this session. Respected chairman of this session, Professor Dr. T.N. Lokande, sir, in this international webinar on environmental changes, biodiversity, and sustainable resource management, which is organized by Santosh Bhumrao Patil Mahavidyalay, Mandrup. In this session, five researchers has presented their papers on the various issues regarding environment.
And hello, sir. Hello. Yes. Am I audible? Sir, I am another paper presenter. May I present my paper?
Yeah, but hello.
Hello, I am Dr. Shantaninath Bhadro. My paper title is Need for Conservation of Asian and African Elephants.
Okay, madam, you should present your paper within 2 to 3 minutes, okay?
Thank you.
Okay.
Good afternoon to all. The title of my paper is Need for Conservation of Asian and African Elephants. The aims and objectives of my study is to evaluate the present status of Asian and African elephants in the context of conservation and to explore the feasibility of conservation of Asian and African elephants. So what are the present condition or situation of the Asian and African elephants? Asian elephant population has declined by an estimated 50% over the past 75 years. 90% of African elephants have been killed in the last 100 years. 20% of African elephants have been lost in the last decade. Approximately 55 African elephants are pouched on the continent every day. 5 tons of elephant tusks were seized in airports along in 2016. We have to conserve elephant due to their several significant on the environment. And what this is, elephants are tourism magnets attracting funding that help protect wildness areas. Elephants are playing an important role in maintaining the biodiversity. Elephants use their tusks to dig for water during the dry season that provide water for other animals. So when drought strike, that share harsh habitat for it, forest elephants when eat create gaps in the vegetation which allow new plants grow. When forest elephants eat, create pathways for other smaller animals to use, etc. and etc. So how to conserve these Asian and African elephants? We have to first of all protect elephant and their habitat, reduce human-elephant conflict, promote elephant-friendly policies through sustainable forest management, ecotourism, implementation of Asian Conservation Act, African Conservation Act, create natural corridors, apply translocation, anti-poaching patrol, establishment of international cooperation, use sustainable alternative like the tagu nut, which is similar to the elephant ivory, construct zoological parks, influence zoological breeding programs, and assisted reproduction. Therefore, we may conclude that elephant is an ecosystem engineer, so we have to conserve these vital vital species in the environment. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, madam. Respected chairman of this session, Professor Dr. T.N. Lokande, sir, on this international webinar on environmental changes biodiversity and sustainable resource management, which is organized by Santosh Bhimrao Patil Mahavidyalaya Mundrup. In this technical session, six researchers have presented their paper on the various issues regarding environment, and they had mentioned the correct issues, and this is important for the environmental on today's scenario. I would like to thanks all these paper presenters, and I also thanks to the organizer, Dr. Santosh Bhimrao Patil, principal of this college, to give me and this opportunity to attend this session as a reporter. Thank you, sir. Hello.
Hello. Hello. More, sir.
Hello. Hello. Lokande sir, bolta. Hello. Hello, Lokande sir.
लोखंडे सर माइक बंद आहे तुमचा.
हॅलो.
ओके.
लोखंडे सर, सर ऐकायला येत नाही. यू आर नॉट ऑडिबल सर. अनम्यूट युअर माइक सर. माने सर.
ओ बोला.
हा मोरे सर, ते वॉट ऑफ थँक्स म्हणतात.
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबडी. आय एम हियर टू प्रपोज अ वोट ऑफ थँक्स. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आय सिन्सिअरली थँक्स प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर एन एन मालदार सर, डॉक्टर गजानन गोडके सर, डॉक्टर एस सी आडितोड सर अँड प्रिन्सिपल बदनोरे सर फॉर देअर व्हॅल्युएबल स्पीच अँड गायडन्स. आय ऑल्सो एक्सटेंड माय थँक्स टू टेक्निकल सेशन चेअरमन डॉक्टर टी एन लोखंडे सर अँड रॅपोर्चर डॉक्टर एच बी तिपे सर अँड ऑल प्रेपर प्रेझेंटेशन अँड ऑल्सो थँकफुल संतोष माने सर फॉर हिज कॉन्ट्रीब्युशन अँड टेक्निकल सपोर्ट. आय ऑल्सो थँक एडिटर अक्षर वाङ्मय यू जी सी केअरलिस्ट जर्नल डॉक्टर नानासाहेब सूर्यवंशी सर. आय ऑल्सो थँक द प्रेसिडेंट सोलापूर जिल्हा समाजसेवा मंडळ सोलापूर, व्हाईस प्रेसिडेंट, सेक्रेटरी अँड ऑल ऑफिस बेअरर फॉर देअर मोटिवेशन. लास्ट आय थँकफुल आवर कॉलेज प्रिन्सिपल डॉक्टर बी एम भांजे सर, कन्व्हिनर डॉक्टर डी के दडे सर, आय क्यू एस सी कोऑर्डिनेटर डॉक्टर सी एस मुलगे सर, ऑल मेंबर्स ऑफ ऑर्गनायझिंग कमिटी,
अँड
all the teaching and non-teaching staff, our college, and our the participants of this webinar. Thank you once again.
Okay. Thank you. Mane sir. Mane sir. Hello. Hello. Hello.
बोला सर.
हाँ माने सर.
हाँ बोला कि सर.
हाँ ओके थैंक यू चांगले झाले.
ओके सर.
ओके 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 थैंक यू.
थैंक यू
माने सर. धन्यवाद.
धन्यवाद.
हाँ ओके ओके
थैंक यू माने सर.
Thank you.